This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Making of a Merchant. Author: The Curtis Publishing Company. Year: 1901. Preface: Comment of any practical value on the subject of the mistakes most frequent among boys and young men entering on a business life is certain to meet with one criticism, which may be epitomized in the single word commonplace. And why? Because these faults are so common that they are impressed on the attention of every large employer of labor, particularly in commercial lines, and he is compelled to reiterate them with emphasis and tiresome persistency. If they were less common, less universally recognized, and uniformly disapproved by employers, their enumeration would not appeal to their victim as commonplace, stereotyped, and uninteresting. Occasionally, however, a boy or young man of sufficient character and receptivity is found who is willing and eager to profit by advice from those of long experience, even though it may be given in painfully familiar terms and may sound sage, tedious, and preachy. It is for the aspiring young men who are animated by this spirit of tractability that these suggestions and comments are made by one whose views are the result of 38 years of experience in unbroken connection with an enterprise that has had many changes in the personnel of proprietorship and now has more than 7,000 employees. In the course of that service, he has filled various positions from the very humblest to that of part proprietor and manager. With the exception of his earliest years, all this period of labor has brought him into direct personal contact with the young employees, and the responsibilities of his position have compelled a daily and unremitting watchfulness of their conduct with the view to determining faults and mistakes which most beset the young adventurer into the mazes of commercial activity. HNH. Chicago, 1906. Chapter 1: Laying the Foundation. As a majority of business positions today are filled by men who entered the harness as boys, the manner in which a boy looks at his first employment is of fundamental importance. Generally, he does not take himself or his duties with sufficient seriousness. He is inclined to think that he is only a boy, and that his work is of boyish inconsequence. Nothing could be further from the real facts than such an impression. To realize this, it is only necessary to go into the office of any large establishment, the business heart of a commercial enterprise, and observe the swarms of boys that flit between the desks of the older workers. Who is always at the elbow of the executive head of an establishment of this kind? A boy. He comes into closer and more continuous contact with the proprietor, the general manager, or the department head than any adult. Because he is only a boy, he is party to private conversations and transactions from which even the confidential man might be barred. This means responsibility and opportunity, and his conduct is, therefore, of greater personal interest and moment to a business executive than he is generally inclined to think. Boys fail to satisfy the demands made upon them, more from the lack of promptness and punctuality than by any other reason. Thousands of dismissals, rebuffs, discouragements, and failures at the beginning of a career could have been avoided by these small workers had they made a cardinal point of being always on hand in their proper places during every moment when subject to duty. It is not enough that they should be generally at their stations. The time is sure to come, no matter how sparingly they allow themselves the indulgence of straying only a little from the rigid requirements of office rules, when they will be suddenly wanted, and will be found wanting. Many falls into the habit of being a few rods, or perhaps only a few feet, from the spot where they are expected to be. This means that the busy employer must leave his desk, or resort to a little extra effort to secure their attention. The actual inconvenience may seem trifling, but he is annoyed. If very charitable, he says, "That's the boy of it," and patiently gives the little toiler another chance. But the boy has failed to come up to reasonable requirements, and suffers accordingly in the estimation of the man that depends upon him for a certain service. Another seemingly petty fault, very common to the younger employees, is the habit of watching the clock. This is little short of infuriating to the man who is genuinely and seriously absorbed in his business. It tells him that the spirit of time serving instead of the welfare of the business is the controlling force in the work of such an employee. This is peculiarly irritating to the man who has a thoughtful and conscientious grasp of the serious side of business life. Any large employer of labor, particularly in office positions, will place heartfelt emphasis on the advice, "Let the clock take care of itself," and show a disposition to be useful without regard to time or closing bells. This is the secret by which a boy, or a young man of even mediocre talents, may win the approval of those whom he serves. "Anything but a time server," has been the exasperated exclamation that has preceded many a dismissal. Quickness to perceive the little things which annoy a busy executive, and promptness in removing them, has secured the promotion of scores of boys and young men who, as the saying goes, have their wits about them. Proprietors and managers of large businesses are human and susceptible to those delicate personal attentions which count so largely in home and social life. And the fact that such an attention comes from a boy, and amid the hurry of business and the commercial surroundings of an office, only goes to make these exhibitions of thoughtfulness more acceptable, pleasing and conspicuous. In a very large degree, whatever of success I have been able to achieve in the mercantile field is due to reaching out for new responsibilities and doing new things without being told. The man who rejoices the heart of the head of a great business is the man who sees something to do and does it without asking any questions. Of course, I do not mean by this that any employee should recklessly usurp the duties or responsibilities of another or of his employer, but within the bounds of reason, B should be extending the radius of his authority and responsibility, and lifting that much, as it were, from the shoulders of his employer. The latter is quick to see the force and value of such a servant, and inwardly remarks, "Here's a man who not only acts but thinks for me. He sees through the eyes of my own self-interest, and initiates and executes in my stead." As to the matters of conduct on the part of employees, which may appear to be of greater moment, it is worthwhile to lay stress on the characteristic of decision, the inclination to act quickly on individual responsibility and stand by the consequences. Rashness may be less at a premium in commercial than military life, but timidity is as much to be avoided in the one as in the other field of activity. Better by far make an occasional mistake of judgment than to halt and hesitate over the routine item of business and consult a superior on affairs which are not of sufficiently unusual character to demand the special exercise of executive discretion and authority. Readiness cheerfully to go anywhere at a moment's notice and at whatever personal inconvenience, to remain absent from home for any length of time that the exigencies of business may demand, and to make the interests of the employer his own, is a most appreciated quality in an employee. It never fails to secure appreciation. A turning point of this kind, in my own experience, so aptly illustrates, is observation that its introduction here may be pardonable. In those early days, travel by rail was a positive hardship compared with present conditions. Sleeping cars were unknown, and trains jolted over rough roadbeds at snail pace. It took 24 hours to go from Chicago to the Missouri River, and the most active young man was not anxious to leave his home and suffer the inconvenience and hard knocks of such a trip. One day, however, I was called into Mr. Leiter's office and asked if I would go out to a distant prairie town and attempt the collection of a bill of $1,400 against a country merchant. That meant much more then than it would now, and although I realized the responsibility of the mission and its difficulties and hardships, I promptly and cheerfully accepted the proposal. From the moment I took the train, I had no other thought than that of accomplishing the object for which I had been sent. I determined to get that money, no matter how long I had to stay for it, or how much hard work or inconvenience might be involved. Arriving at the little village, I found a representative of another wholesale house, to which was indebted in the amount of $4,000, had been there before me, looked the ground over, and left on the next train, abandoning his mission as hopeless for the time being. I was not making trains, and frankly told the storekeeper that I had come to stay until I could go away with the firm's money in my pocket. When he grasped the situation, he disclosed all his private business affairs to me, and I found he owned the local grain elevator, the hay scales, and other outside deals. Then I secured from him an option on these, went to other men in the town and disposed of them. This reduced his account by several hundred dollars. Then I made a list of the accounts he held against farmers and other residents, secured the notes of the most responsible debtors, and discounted their paper at the bank. Finally, I took back to Chicago a number of pieces of valuable dress goods of which the merchant had an overstock. All these things satisfied the claim which I had been sent to collect. It was a proud moment for me when I went into Mr. Leiter's private office and gave an account of my week in the prairie town collecting a bad debt. The trip had a strong and direct influence on my advancement. It taught me a lesson, and if it may do as much for any young man of today, its narration is justified. Occasionally, employees count on their church and Sunday school connections and activities as a means of impressing their employers with their worthiness. This is a misjudgment of human nature, and a mistake. Nor is this view any reflection on churches or religion, although it is an undeniable fact that today, a man's credit is not strengthened by his church alliances. That which injures a young man's standing with his employer in this event is the fact that he seeks, directly or indirectly, to make business capital of his religious affiliations. It is not what a man believes or professes, but what he is and does that gives him standing and credit. A man may make a fad of so good a thing as a Sunday school, and it matters little what the fad followed by an employee may be. The moment its existence is known to the employer, the latter regards it as an interloping interest likely to distract the mind from business. This feeling may be selfish and perhaps unjust, but its recognition is not to be ignored by the discreet employee. The knowledge that an employee belongs to a club that is not distinctly beyond his means is not a detriment to his advancement. Often it is an advantage. An early marriage, unless unfortunate, is a benefit to the young salaried businessman. It is difficult to conceive of an employer so devoid of human feeling that he will not take into consideration the dependent wives and children in dismissing and hiring employees. If compelled to choose between a single and a married man of equal merit, the conscientious employer will invariably select the latter. Generally, he will even stretch a point in favor of the man of family. Naturally, one of the first things for the beginner in a mercantile house to decide will be whether he will cast his lot with the selling or the office branch of the work. Too often, this is determined by chance or circumstance instead of by thoughtful selection on the part of the person concerned, and results in placing him for life in a line of effort for which he has less liking and capacity than one he might have chosen to follow in the employ of the same house. Some men are natural salesmen. They have the selling instinct keenly developed, and it is as natural for them to convince customers of the merits of goods as to breathe. For a young man gifted with this selling capacity to work along the course of an office career is a lamentable waste of material. But this is constantly occurring because beginners get started in situations not in the line of their best abilities, and continue therein for no other reason than that they are started there and have not enough discernment to see that they are not working along the line of least resistance, or because, seeing this, they have not enough decision or force to find a place of the sort for which they are best adapted. In many cases, however, they lack enough force and decision to discover their own natural bent and to shape circumstances to develop that tendency. Of such, it is sometimes observed that they do not know their own minds because they have none to know. While this may be a trifle harsh, it is altogether too true, and those who merit this criticism are the hawkers of stone and the drawers of water, those who continue to do the rougher and poorly paid work of a large establishment. Chapter 2: Advancement in Business. In the United States Navy, no officer is eligible into promotion until he is able immediately and without further preparation to discharge the full duties of the position just ahead of him in the line. More than in the Navy, perhaps, this principle of advancement holds good in mercantile life, and particularly in its wholesale branch. So important is it that I should place it first among the things to be observed by the young man beginning his business life. Always he should be reaching out for the definite and practical knowledge that will enable him to do the work of the man immediately above him. To do this does not imply that the need makes that man feel that someone is trying to push him off the payroll or crowd him out of the house. Neither does it carry the implication that the ambitious young employee is justified in neglecting the slightest detail of labor belonging to his own position in order to familiarize himself with those of the man into whose shoes he hopes to step. Either of these inferences is absurd and unwarranted, a fact which will not hinder certain persistently impractical persons from at once drawing such a conclusion. The man who has enough native tact to become a successful merchant will not advertise his ambitions for promotion to the discomfort of the man whose place he hopes to secure, but he will quietly and persistently absorb the information which will enable him to discharge that person's duties, provided the latter were himself suddenly promoted. On the other hand, the man who should hope to win promotion by neglecting a present responsibility for the purpose of studying a future one would display an unpardonable lack of ordinary common sense. But in any event, let it be clear that in the struggle for advancement in the employ of a modern business house, the boy or young man who is content to do only the task assigned him without any interest in that process of the work next beyond him need not hope for promotion. If it comes to him, it is because the person who must determine the promotion has not been sufficiently alert to detect the lack of a normal curiosity, to say nothing of a proper self-interest. As in the Navy, so in the big mercantile establishment, there is little or no time for learning the duties of a position after having been promoted to it. Especially is this true of the higher places of an executive character. Responsibility does not wait upon personal convenience or the slow process of leisurely apprenticeship taken while in the enjoyment of the honors and emoluments of a journeyman. Under the high pressure of modern business life, full exercise of authority and a complete shouldering of responsibility must begin at the moment a man nominally assumes a position, and generally they begin before he takes the place as his own. It is for this reason that I place so much emphasis upon the necessity of learning how to do the thing not required today, but which may, by virtue of some sudden emergency, be demanded tomorrow, when there will be not a moment for getting posted. I doubt if today there is a man at the head of a department in the large wholesale enterprise with which I was associated for many years, who has not won his place through the consistent exercise of this outreaching for a knowledge of the thing immediately in front of him. Generally, however, a man is most impressed by the achievement of the person succeeding in a field of effort other than that in which he is struggling, and I shall therefore illustrate my point by reference to the career of a man who has made his name widely known in the grain trade. He started in by tending the telephone at a grain elevator and keeping the weights, that is, copying the scale tickets into a book, when not busy at the phone. He made it a business always to be caught up with his work, so it often happened when he went to the scale floor for the tickets that they were not ready for him. This gave the young man leisure to become familiar with the weighman's work and with the scales and machinery of the elevator. Occasionally he induced the weighman to let him tend one scale and later two scales until he became thoroughly familiar with the work. About this time, his employer built a new elevator, and the young man applied for the position of timekeeper. Undismayed by the reply that the timekeeper would be expected, in addition to his regular work, to tally and record every load of lumber, stone, brick, sand, iron, and other material going into the construction of the elevator, he eventually secured the position. The elevator was built by day labor instead of by contract. The first day, 20 men started work. The second day, there were 40. The third day, 60, and so on until the full quota of nearly 200 men was engaged. Despite the fact that these laborers were of almost a dozen different nationalities, the young timekeeper so familiarized himself with their names and faces that he was able to call by name each man who had worked for even a single day. He could also tell quite as readily in what part of the building each man worked, and he missed at once any laborer who stole away for an hour or two at a neighboring saloon. When the elevator was completed, a wayman was needed, and the young man applied for the position. After convincing his employer that he understood the work, and that he had watched the construction of every grain spout, and therefore knew into what bin each one led, and that he would not have to learn that anew, he was given the position. He soon became so expert that the weighing did not require his entire time, and during moments otherwise unoccupied, he turned his attention to the working of the cleaning machines on the same floor, and was finally allowed to tend these machines in addition to the work of weighing. He became an expert in the art of telling at a glance the exact grade of a given sample of wheat, and during this schooling he managed to learn from the foreman just how grain is mixed to produce a given grade. His perseverance in learning everything that could be learned about the business soon gave him the name of being the best grain expert in the elevator. He held this enviable position in the eyes of his fellow workers for a number of years. One day, one of the young man's employers came to him and said, "I am going to buy you a membership on the Board of Trade. You can buy car lots down there. I have been watching you, and I hear from people around here that you are as good a judge of grain as there is. You are just the fellow we want." Then began his career as a commission merchant. But the keynote of his advancement from one position to another was that of learning how to do the work of the position next in the line of promotion. It works in the general mercantile business as well as in the grain trade. I have been asked to designate certain books and articles which may afford practical assistance to young men seeking to get on in the field of merchandising. This I shall do in concluding this chapter, but I shall fail of my full duty if I do not make it very clear to every reader that no amount of outside reading can take the place of or compare in importance with the lessons to be learned by actual observation in the rush working hours. When the lessons which fall under the eye of the alert observer are amplified by means of judicious inquiry, then decisive progress is inevitable. And without this, no amount of parallel study or theoretical research will avail. In the first month of service in a large establishment, every employee should become complete master of the general structure of the enterprise. That framework of organization by which the enterprise is sustained should stand out as clearly before the eyes of the boy or young man who has become a part of its mechanism, as would the beams, sills, braces, and other timbers of a cabin being built by his own hands and destined to be his lifelong home. Grand divisions, subdivisions, and departments should be sharply defined and their relationship understood. He should be able minutely, and without the omission of a single step or detail, to trace any article of merchandise from the moment of its arrival inside the house until it is in the hands of the customer. Not only this, but he should also be able to furnish an equally accurate and detailed narrative of the process in the way of accounting, which accompanies and records the passage of this piece of goods from the receiving door to the shipping platform. This is equivalent to learning the main thoroughfares and car lines of a strange city. After that has been accomplished, the newcomer has the far more subtle and difficult task of becoming acquainted with the inhabitants of the place, and of learning the peculiar traits and characteristics which give them their individuality. So in the business house. After the boy who has begun his apprenticeship has learned the main points of the compass and can trace any kind of goods on its journey from factory to customer, he must still acquaint himself with the personnel of the establishment. And it is here that he will learn what gives the house its individuality, its points of difference from other enterprises in the same line of trade. And in proportion as he is able to discern the personal equation of the house, of its officials and department heads, he will demonstrate his fitness for commercial life, which mainly is the game of judging human nature and of following a well-ordered system and method of doing things. Any boy of fair intelligence who applies himself faithfully to the task of getting his bearings in this particular will be able to tell in a very short time what may reasonably be expected of any particular man in the house, how he does his work, what he expects from those under his charge, how he conducts himself toward those in authority over him, how he administers and receives discipline, on what points in business ethics he is most insistent, and where he is inclined to be lax or lenient, what is the surest road to his approval and to his displeasure, and most important of all, what are the peculiarities which make him most valuable to the house and secure his permanent employment and advancement. These and a score of other equally significant inquiries should come spontaneously into the mind of every wide-awake boy or young man and find insistent application to every man of any importance in the house. And if this close study and observation of character is not spontaneous, it should be cultivated until the young student of human nature.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.